the former BBC professor Leno. And incidentally, your former bursa has just resumed work in my office as my special advisor on education science. So we are here to so thank you all very much for being here today. We're looking forward to the lecture. And congratulations to everybody. And congratulations to Lagos State, Professor Sami, to the University of Lagos. And I wish us all the useful deliberations. Thank you.
All protocol duly observed. I noticed that there was some conspicuous omission in the protocol.
Yes.
One was remedied, and that's Professor Ipaye. We welcome you back to your territory. The other is the chairman of Lagos Lunar and the New, so you survive. We welcome you back. Thank you very much, Lagos State. I must let you know that my being able to come here today is simply because I thought the thank you was significant. Earlier in the morning, we started the funeral service of one of our greatest scholars at this university, Professor Vincent Ululoya, properly known as Boso. And after the event, I was too drained emotionally to go to Lagos and really turn back. But realizing how topical this was and seeing the effort you made to attract who is who in the financial world of Nigeria to come here, it was only mandatory that I found myself here today. I joined the minister in thanking Lagos State Government. But my protest is two-pronged. One, please let the governor know that the sort of endowment we're expecting from Lagos State, from the government headed by an alumnus of this university, is significantly higher than what we have said he has sent to us, while saying thank you to him. In the same vein, I challenge the minister that before you increase the one of Lagos State, when are we getting your own? Putting it on record, I was expecting a multifaceted endowment from the Minister of Finance and our friends from the University of Lagos. The chairman, Inland Revenue, is here, Federal and Lagos. I've never seen the two in the same gathering unless there is someone to Abuja. We want to benefit from that working together. And I hope that we will receive significant endowments from the two institutions. Let me assure you that this is the best place to put your money. We have the intellectual capacity, we have the potential resources, and we are determined to create an institution that is second to none in Africa. Any money you place with us is safe because it is soundly managed, it will be ring-fed, and be used for the purpose you have. Put it down there. What is our basic problem? Government alone cannot fund education. Government alone cannot fund education. We receive between 9 and 10 billion per annum from the federal government. But to create the sort of institution we require to be able to compete, to go back to the era where we were the resource base for most intellectual achievement, I think we need about 3 times that per annum. Going to government to beg for this, yes, we want more, but I think we should challenge ourselves. The alumni association of UniLife, those who have benefited from UniLife, can do very well in achieving this objective. Lastly, my brief comment on taxation. I was extremely excited when I was told that the chair had been endowed on taxation. I had taken a very indifferent attitude to taxation law because I couldn't reconcile the brilliance that was required in practicing tax law and the operation I saw in Nigeria. Tax is a brilliant man's game. Government at every stage seeks to tax. The taxpayer does everything to avoid tax, not evade tax. But government is always smarter than the taxpayer by coming up with regulations that are defined, that are ascertainable, but they are invariably the product of brilliance. For those who are familiar with tax law, I refer you to the early 80s when tax avoidance in England was being retuned. That's Duke and IRC, Ramsey and IRC, Fornes and Dawson. These were cases of serious articulation. These were cases of demonstrable brilliance. These were judges who rose above the pedestrian. This is what we're trying to groom in UniLife. This is what we'll groom with your support. I thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Wale Babalakin, SAN Chairman, Government Captain of the University of Lagos. Ladies and gentlemen, with us here today is Chief D.A. Olonleke, Doyen of Tax Profession in Nigeria. Please, a round of applause. We have Chief C.I. and the President C.I.T.N. with us here as well. Please, another round of applause. We have the former PVC, Professor Duro Oni, with us here as well. You're welcome, sir. Director of Academic Planning, Professor Okunuga, you're welcome. Chairman of the Government Council of the University of Lagos, just challenged the Honorable Minister. Ladies and gentlemen, how can a young man, a young boy, whose opportunity to be the MC today, challenge the Honorable Minister? Ladies and gentlemen, I was opportunity to host a function like this 2 weeks ago, and the representative of the donor in Akwa Ibom just gave me a check of $200,000, just like that. Another one that I did 3 weeks ago at the Gold Institute, the representative of the governor looked at me and said, "Let me say, I love your voice." Just give me 500,000, just like that. Another one that I did at Bamora Event Center, the representative of the governor of Enugu State just looked at me and said, "I don't really have cash, give me 150,000 naira, just like that." And not before the Honorable Minister of Finance meets here today, she will do better.
have to say that the governor is not able to make it today because of state matters that are taking into Abuja. It's aptly to represent him and also deliver this speech on his behalf. The Honorable Minister of Finance, Mrs. Kenya Joshua. I think when I was coming in, I saw, and I would like to recognize the former Deputy Governor of Lagos State, Otumba Femi Pedro. The Pro Chancellor, Investor of Lagos, Dr. Wade Lumalaka, SAN. The Vice Chancellor, University of Lagos, and my teacher, Professor Wadden Odeko. Professor Rahman Ebelo, former VC, the Chairman Board of Trustees, Professor Eji Omolehima, and other members of the Board of Trustees. I also like to recognize Dr. Mayudu, the former Patron General of the Federation. Mr. Abubakar, the Chairman of FIRS. And when the MC was declaring his income, I just realized that we have not recognized properly the chairman of Lagos Internal Revenue Service. And the I would like to recognize the permanent secretary, Office of Finance, Mr. Balogun. Lagos State officials here present because this is your day. The Lagos State Professor of Tax and Fiscal Matters, Professor Abelasan, in honor of whom we are all gathered here today, distinguished professors of this great university, members of Lagos State Executive Council here present, members of the press, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Welcome. Let me start by first congratulating Professor Odipe on your recent appointment as the Vice Chancellor of this great university. I pray and believe that the university will achieve phenomenal growth under your watch and leadership. I'm very delighted to be attending this event as a special guest of honor. For me, as a proud alumnus of this university, this is more of a homecoming, and I'm happy to be home. And I will say, greatest acolytes. Taxation is the lifeblood of any state or nation. It is in realization of this that successive administrations in Lagos State, since the return of democracy in 1999, have progressively made remarkable efforts at improving the tax system of the state. As a state, Lagos has evolved over the past decade from being predominantly dependent on transfers from the Federation accounts, as is still the case with most states in the country, to being self-sustaining through its internally generated revenue. To drive this trend, we launched a wide range of reforms geared towards enhancing the state's revenue base and improving our budgetary and expenditure control processes. These reforms resulted in the quantum leap in the state's internal generated revenue, IGR, backed by efficient billing and collection of revenue and blocking of leakages through deployment of technology. The success achieved from our various reforms have set Lagos aside as a trailblazer and benchmark for other states to emulate. Critical to these achievements were strong and visionary leadership, stability of government and consistency in government policies, robust legal and regulatory framework, enhanced cooperation between the state government and local governments, amongst others. Even today, particularly given the current economic realities, we are still constantly trying to maximize our revenue collection from existing sources, as well as exploring new areas to boost our IGR base to support the development agenda of this administration. As a government, We are bullish in our attempts to deliver sustainable economic growth and development that will culminate in prosperity for our people, as well as improvement in the ease of doing business in Lagos State and Nigeria by extension. Our IGR will continue to be the catalyst for achieving the level and pace of infrastructure development that will enable us to transform Lagos into a smart city, whether in terms of being a self-financing source or providing more headroom for additional manageable debt stock. However, we believe that our current tax administration processes could and should be better. Issues such as multiplicity of taxes, flexibility of payment processes, and so on and so forth present a challenge which my administration is seriously looking to tackle head on, even as we strive to curb the high level of tax evasion. As the minister was talking about VAT, came to mind kids, people having kids in abroad, maybe 4 or 5, and wanting them to as unliable expenses. And I was talking to myself that in Lagos State, for instance, we have about 5 million in our database, and about 600,000 file returns. So that's the gap. So these people don't go file returns. Maybe that's why I feel like this provides opportunity to achieve that. And thank you to the minister for this. We will therefore continue to enlighten our people of their civic duty to file their complete tax returns and pay their taxes, while also maintaining accountability and transparency in the utilization of the state's limited resources. Given the foregoing, it is very interesting that today's lecture title, Policy, Legal and Administrative Imperatives in the Quest for Eradicating Multiplicity of Taxes in Lagos State, which we are about to receive from the esteemed Professor Sonny, is taking place at this time, particularly as the state government is currently in the process of implementing new reforms that will enable us to achieve another leap in the IGR from the current level to about 50 billion monthly to support our infrastructure development agenda. You can therefore appreciate why I'm truly looking forward to the lecture to provide deeper insights on evolving and new issues pertaining to tax and fiscal matters. Knowing Professor Sonny, I expect his lecture to be thought-provoking, insightful, and illuminating. I will be listening very attentively and I enjoy you to do so. Finally, in recognition of the depth of the contribution of the Faculty of Law, University of Lagos in the field of transition, we broke new grounds with the endowment of Lagos State Professor Chair in Tax and Fiscal Matters. And the minister has said we can do more. But as much as I would like to align with her, I still remember the fiscal federalism that we practice. She represents the federal government, and I represent the subnational Lagos State government. And I will pass the message to my principal. But let it not be said that federal government is taking decision on their own Lagos State government. We are proud to identify with the university, the Faculty of Law, and the occupier of the chair in this great enterprise. We hope to leverage on the research outcomes from this body towards continuous development of our tax system and solving the problem of multiplicity of taxes in Lagos State and Nigeria. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening. Enjoy the rest of the program, and I'll end by saying, it is Siwaju Ifunleku.
Thank you, the representative of the governor of Lagos State, Mr. Kemi Abode, Mr. Shadi, thank you so much. With us here today, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to recognize the director of some advancement, Mrs. Ibunke Salam. Thank you so much for coming. We appreciate your efforts. All deans, all directors, all HODs, all students, all professors, I mean,
Mrs. Kemi, Chairman, Government Council, University of Lagos, Dr. Wale Babalakin, SAN, Vice Chancellor Professor Tony Ogunike, immediate past Vice Chancellor Professor Rahman Bey, Principal Officer of the University of Lagos, Dean Faculty of Law, Chairman FIRM, Mr. Babatunde Fowler, eminent professors, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, This is the citation of Professor Abiola's son, Fellow Chartered Taxation Institute, Fellow Chartered Institute for Habitation. Abiola Sani was born on the 5th of July, on the 5th of June 1965, to the family of Pa Samuel Eluwole and Comfort Elutidoye Eluwole of Ilara and Ile Opa compound of Ile Ife, Osun State. He is the fourth child in a family of five, comprising four males and one female. He attended St. Murumba Catholic Primary School, Ile Ife, between 1970 and 1976. St. Lawrence Catholic Grammar School, Ilesha, between 1978 and 1983. And Oyo State College of Arts and Science, Oscar, Ile Ife, Osun State, between 1983 and 1985. He bagged his Bachelor and Master of Laws degree from Obafemi Awolowo University, OAU. In 1989 and 1992, respectively, and doctorate degree in commercial law, specializing in law of taxation from University of Lagos in 2010. On 16 August 2016, he was simultaneously appointed as a professor of commercial law, University of Lagos, and Lagos State Professor of Tax and Fiscal Matters, a chair endowed by Lagos State Government for a period of 3 years. Abiola Sani started his teaching career in OAU as a junior trainee fellow in 1991. He rose through the ranks to the position of lecturer one and served as acting head, Department of Business Law, in 1997. He was perhaps the youngest person, both in age and years of service in the university, to occupy that exalted position at the time. While at OAU, he reintroduced labor law into the curriculum and exhibited exemplary leadership by coordinating a crop of six dynamic young lecturers of the faculty to publish in 1998 the first book on legal methods in Nigeria. The book, Introduction to Nigerian Legal Methods, which has earned the sobriquet the Blue Bible in this university, has since emerged as the leading introductory legal text in Nigerian universities and the West African sub-region. In search of specialization and career advancement, Abiola Sani transferred his service to University of Lagos in 1999. In 2003, he won the prestigious Fulbright Fellowship for Foreign Scholars, coordinated by the United States Department of coordinated by the United States Department of State Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs. He did a 10-month fellowship at the International Tax Program of Business School of Law, Temple University, Philadelphia, USA, where he was also appointed a research fellow of the Institute of International Law and Policy of the same university. Abiola Sani is a thoroughbred professional with robust multidisciplinary background. He is a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Taxation of Nigeria and currently serves the CITN in different capacities. He is Dean of the Indirect Tax Faculty and legal advisor and member of the Taxation Standards Board. is also fellow of the Chartered Institute of Arbitration of Nigeria and a life member of the Nigerian Society of International Law. He has served as consultant to leading consulting firms, including Ernst & Young, and was consultant to the House of Representatives, the Sixth Parliament, on a series of 2007 tax laws. Abiola Sani is a firm believer in alternative dispute resolution and has acted as an arbitrator in a number of international arbitrations. Abiola Sani has also served in different capacities and is engaged in research that promotes education, growth, and development in Nigeria and outside Nigeria. He has served as the chairman of the National Committee on the Review of the Nigerian Tax Policy in 2016, an assignment that the committee completed in record time of 6 weeks in order to sustain the tempo of the ongoing reform initiative. He was recently appointed as the chairman of the National Tax Policy Implementation Committee. He is member advisory group of the International Center for Tax and Development, a global policy research network devoted to improving the quality of tax policy and administration in developing countries, with special focus on sub-Saharan Africa. The research is funded by the UK Department for International Development and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Abiola Sani is the coordinator of the Tax Club, a vibrant student advocacy group. He's a trustee and the first chairman of Tax Academician Association of Nigeria, a corporate platform for teachers of taxation in faculties of law, departments of accounting and economics in tertiary institutions in Nigeria. He has served and continues to serve the University of Lagos in many capacities. Is currently the Hallmaster of the Obaku Hall and member of the University Leader Advisory Board from 2012 till date. His legal advisor, Academic Staff Union of Nigerian University from 2008 till date, is the chairman of Welfare, Gender and Social Justice Committee of Academic Staff Union of Universities, University of Lagos chapter from 2016 to date. He was the chairman UNILAG Senior Staff Club at 50 Celebration Committee. Abiola Sani was at various times the coordinator, diploma in commercial and industrial law between 1999 and 2002. He was staff advisor, Law Student Society between 2003 and 2008. He was member, Student Disciplinary Board, University of Lagos between 2011 and 2015. He is staff advisor, Kayode Esho Chambers, Faculty of Law, University of Lagos, from 2009 till date. He was chairman, Roundtable Committee, Faculty of Law, 2009-2007. He had served on several high-profile disciplinary and investigation panels, too numerous to mention here. He was a member of the University of Lagos Student Union Constitution Drafting Committee in 2014, chairman of the University of Lagos Student Union Electoral Petition Committee in 2014, and Secretary General Ransom Kuti Rhodes Resident Association, University of Lagos from 2000 to 2015. Abiola Sani is a regular speaker at tax and legal conferences within and outside Nigeria. He has used the platform to inspire a number of professionals in developing and sustaining their interest in taxation. As many of his students, my humble self included, will testify, Abiola Sani is an outstanding teacher and mentor. He has a positive has a positive and infectious can-do attitude which inspires all his students. Abiola's Sani's career success is mirrored in his private life. He maintains a healthy life-work balance through recreational and social activities. He's a member of FS Club, Octagon 19, Unilag Staff Club, Ife Recreation Club, Ikoyi Club 1938, and Brothers for Life, a social platform for alumni of OAU who graduated between 1985 and 1990 to give back to their alma mater. Abiola is a Christian and happily married to Princess Omushola Sunny, a dying wife for 25 years. The marriage is blessed with four adorable children, Oluwatutewa, Bakewa.
Policy, legal and administrative imperative in the quest for eradicating multiplicity of taxes in Lagos State. This is a problem that has challenged us, and we have tried all ways in order to solve it. Brilliant minds, institutions have put hands together, put brains together in order to find a pathway that will lead to sustainable solutions, but we have not been able to hit the nail on the head. So this is an attempt in order to share my bold thoughts on what I think the problem are and how we may resolve the problem. So then, ladies and gentlemen, I read the first paragraph, then I speak to the rest. This topic reveals the intractable nature of the phenomenon called multiplicity of taxes in Nigeria. Despite the efforts aimed at addressing it, it also reflects the need to consider fresh interventions from the dimensions of tax policy, law, and administration. Multiplicity of taxes in Nigeria has over time attracted national and international opprobrium. In 2016, Nigeria was ranked 182 out of 190 countries on ease of paying taxes survey. On the basis that there were 59 tax payments with average rate of 34.3%, which require about 908 hours to comply. By contrast, Qatar, which came first, had only 4 tax payments, an average rate of 11.3%, requiring an average of 41 hours to comply. It is possible, I'm not very sure, it is just possible that the survey may have been influenced by taxes and levies approved list of collection act, which I will subsequently refer to as CAPT2, which gave the false and erroneous impression that there's a long list of taxes in Nigeria. I chose this topic, ladies and gentlemen, because when Professor Edie Omonenua, the chairman of the Board of Trustees, led the committee the board to the governor, and he said frankly that he wanted to do something about this in the past, in Nigeria, and also in Lagos State. With this, I was emboldened. I said, now the governor has said his mind, let us try and see what we can do to help. So there may be a few things I'm going to say this evening that we need to go and carefully look at in order to see whether they may actually contain the seed of the solution to the problem. I've divided the discussion into 7 parts. In part 1, which is the introduction, part 2, I conceptualize the phrases, taxes, levies, and also what do we mean by multiplicity of taxes in the light of the peculiarities of Nigeria. In part 3, I interrogated the extent that multiplicity of taxes do exist in Lagos. Then part 4, I looked at the evolution of multiplicity of taxes in order to identify the cost. Part five, I look at the adequacy and otherwise of all the interventions of the past. In part six, I look at the need of policy, administrative, and legal interventions that may be required while I conclude in part seven. Part two, I look at taxes and levies. Except in Nigeria, I don't think there's anywhere where the two words will normally go together. But in Nigeria, you can hardly talk about one without the other. So, do they mean the same thing? Do they mean the same, different things? If they mean the same thing, why are we describing the same thing in two different ways? And I looked at it and I gave a definition, a proper definition of tax, which tallies with what the definition of the revised national tax policy. And here we refer to taxes as all compulsory payments to government without any direct benefit to the payer, irrespective of the name that it is called. I pay my tax every month, every year. LIRS had never, Lagos State had never done something specifically in return for that. And that applies to everyone here. But Lagos State has been using our tax revenue to develop the state generally, and it has the prerogative to determine the allocation of revenue in terms of priorities of government. So I said, we should use the word tax only for payments for which there is no direct benefit. Then what about levy? Levies, the meaning is wider in the sense that it also includes taxes. Because if you look at the word levy as a verb and also as a noun it means any payment. So if you are talking about any compulsory payment to government, whether there is a direct benefit or not, you are, it is appropriate to use the word levy. But there are so many levies for which you can see a direct link between the payment and also certain services that are being conferred on the payer. When you pay for permit to erect a building, that is a levy, it's not a tax. When you pay for permit in order to have a license for your car, that is, there are so many things you have to seek government approval for in order for you to proceed. So anytime there is, the guideline rule is if there is a direct link between the payment and also certain services, it is a levy and not a tax. And I concluded in this part by advocating that we should disaggregate the meaning of taxes and levies. And we should use taxes only for payment for which there is no direct benefit, and also use levies for payment for which there is direct benefit. I then come to multiplicity of taxes on page 7. And I look at how the National Tax Policy 2012 defined this phenomenon. And that document defines multiplicity of taxes only in terms of its manifestation at the state and local government level. And this gave a false impression that there are no multiplicity of taxes at the federal level, which I disagree with. Then have then decided to look at multiplicity of taxes holistically in a broader way, because most of the interventions have been aimed at addressing some part of the manifestations and not everything. So from the general usages by stakeholders, and multiplicity of taxes can manifest in at least 4 ways. The first one refers to unlawful compulsory payments being collected by states and local governments without appropriate legal backing through intimidation and harassment. Collection is characterized by use of fear. That's the one we're most familiar with. You are going on the road, even the minister and the FRA was maybe victim. In those circumstances, you don't really have a choice. Those are not taxes. But they manifest because the machinery for collection at that level either does not exist or is very, very weak. Second, multiplicity of taxes refers to cases in which various government agencies charge exorbitant amounts for licenses, permits, ostensibly in the need to generate more revenue.
God bless you, bro.
So there are so many things that people have been used to enjoying in the past in accessing government services, which they can no longer patronize today because they will cause harm and error. The effect is more on those who are running businesses. And there is a harsh word by Justice Outer in the case of registered trustee of Association of the Licensed Communications Operations of Nigeria and Lagos State Government. In that law, the judge said IMRAS, an agency of the Lagos State, was only pursuing revenue objective through that law, when the objective should actually be regulatory. I mean, the purpose should be to see whether people who are applying are qualified and to see whether the standards are met. They are meant for standard setting, they are meant for regulation of behavior, and they are not meant mainly for revenue generation. Third, it refers to the situation where the same level of government imposes two or more taxes on the same tax base. A good example here is a multi-layer levels of taxes under company's income tax, tertiary education tax, information technology tax, and so on and so forth. This manifests almost exclusively at the federal level. So the first layer of taxation of income of companies in Nigeria is a tax of 30% of the net profit. The second layer is a tax of 2% of the accessible profit under tertiary education trust fund. Then the third layer is information technology tax of 1% of the gross profit of certain companies. I believe that the emerging tax reform in Nigeria will find a way to streamline these three or more taxes into one, and then balance the competing interest in order to improve its ranking on the ease of paying taxes in this. Because on this court alone, the outside world will look at us and say, what is happening here? If you want to mark up the company's income tax, you can as well do it, and then earmark the revenue from it for these other purposes. Because some of these special taxes have a way of actually motivating the introduction of more. And that is why it is bad policy to have special taxes at all. Then the fourth refers to the situation where the taxpayer is faced with demands from two or more different levels of government, either for the same or similar taxes. A good example here is the administration of value-added tax and also the hotel occupancy and restaurant consumption tax simultaneously. The multiplicity of taxes manifests in this manner only in Lagos State and other states that have followed the Lagos model. I also believe that emerging tax reform in Lagos State will find a way to streamline these two taxes and then balance the competing interests. Viewed from this broad perspective, it can be seen that none of the key levels of government is free from blame. The danger in construing multiplicity of taxes narrowly is that intervention will not be broad-based. And that is why we are saying, let's look at all this together holistically and see the appropriate responses for each of them. The Honorable Minister has said a lot about the menace of multiplicity of taxes. I can't improve on that. It actually paints us that in international community, it hurts businesses, and there are cases, documented cases of businesses that have moved out of Lagos and out of Nigeria because of their crime of multiplicity of taxes. So, ladies and gentlemen, I now move on page 13 to look at the extent that multiplicity of taxes exists in Lagos. And I looked at it and I can see it. Because actually, if you look at Lagos, there are two main taxes at the state level and two at the local government level. We do not have several taxes. I think the main problem is various agencies seeking to outdo one another in generating revenue and also in skewing their licensing fee, permit fee, exorbitantly high. So, how did I arrive at this? I looked at the tax laws in Lagos, I'm on page 14, and I found only 9 taxes. A careful review of the above, however, will reveal that only 3 of them, that is the hotel occupancy and restaurant consumption law, the land use charge, and the wharf landing fee, are currently being administered in Lagos. Some of the tax laws have either become obsolete or overreached by federal statutes and should have been omitted during the revision of the laws of Lagos in 2015. There is much to be said about the situation where the laws of Lagos State 2015 still contains a number of tax laws that have become obsolete or impliedly repealed. It is recommended that the executive should initiate bills to repeal this law. Because if they are doing rankings, these are the things that people will come into and then read meanings into them that all of them are still in operation. In practice, because we try to create a link between theory and practice. In practice, however, taxes in Lagos State can be classified into the following 3 categories. Federal taxes administered by state for its account. State taxes administered by the state for its own account. Then local government taxes are delivered by the state for their joint account. Now, under federal taxes administered by the state for its account, we have 3. These are personal income tax, capital gains tax, and stamp duties. For these taxes, Lagos State cannot do anything because item 59 confers the legislative power on the National Assembly. Lagos State cannot change the rate, and Lagos State has never tried to do so. So, but where people complain is that they think Lagos State is sometimes very aggressive in its revenue drive. And my comment is that there's nothing wrong in principle for tax authority to relentlessly seek to implement the provisions of an external law, provided it is done with fairness and impartiality. For instance, Lagos State Internal Revenue Service came out with a number of about 13 public notices to send, seeking to plug the various means that people have been exploiting to pay into or nothing. A lot of people have come to say, why should Lagos do that? My question is, why should they do that? Because these are the avenues that Lagos State revenue profile is bleeding. And as responsible people, they needed to do something. So issues like this, there are few taxpayers who may genuinely be angry. So, and some of them have actually approached the court. And there is also an area where people will claim that states, including Lagos, will insist that non-residents who are accessing services in Lagos should also obtain tax clearance in Lagos. I can attest that this is an old practice that has stopped. But the perception out there is still that this is continuing. And my concluding remark here is that it's now a case of first impression lasting longest. because I know that there are some of these things that have been addressed even since the days of Mr. Fowler. But some people still think that because they have come to see that this is what they do, and because that was about the only experience they had, they thought that is still the order of the day. Then I now come to state taxes administered for its account. Here we have only one, which is the consumption tax, which was introduced by Lagos because of its informed position that supply of goods and services within Lagos is actually within the jurisdiction of the state. And they said, we will not let go. But right now, the base of consumption tax in Lagos is limited to the hospitality industry. While Lagos State is still collecting revenue from the value-added tax. So that is the prime revenue of Lagos State now. And in the federation, the tax system is allocated in such a way that at least each level of government will have access to one very buoyant and one revenue base that is very, very broad, so that the government can do something meaningful through appropriate tax policy and adjustment. So that is the only tax that Lagos State is administering now. In fact, the future of Lagos State, in my view, hangs on how well this tax is administered. And you see my conclusion at the end. The taxes administered by state for local government. Right now, Lagos State is the one administering two important taxes. One important tax, land use tax, and another one, work landing fee for the state, for the local government. Local governments in Lagos are currently not administering any taxes, which I don't think is in tandem with the best practice. Because we must recognize that government at that level is the closest, and if they do not have access to their own revenue, they are bound to embark on fiscal recklessness or irresponsible fiscal misbehavior that is going to embarrass the state and also embarrass the nation. The Constitution has provided about four prongs for the revenue of the state, of local government. And we need to go back to this and ensure that local governments are made to play their role and also have access to sufficient revenue to do this. So the next one is off-landing fee. Off-landing fee is payable on goods brought into local governments in Lagos State from the port. The highest fee payable under that law is just 1,000 naira. And that is in respect of 40-foot container or truck or heavy truck. A 20-foot container attracts only 500 naira. So my take about this is that why there may be justification for a port state to actually insist on charging something for passages by all these heavy duty trailers and all that, we have to balance the interest of the state against the Trade and Commerce Clause in the Constitution. And also the possibility that in future, more than two local governments can actually try to collect the same tax as vehicles move. Although at the moment, there is a mechanism to ensure that it is collected only at one spot. So Lagos has good reason in deteriorating routes and all that, and the externalities generated by all the activities in the port. But some we also argue that port locations confer some unique opportunities, such as heavy federal presence, high population density, location and localization of industry, which may positively impact on the revenue of the locality. A lot of states will be very happy to swap position with Lagos State as far as some of these issues are concerned. So while this point may be valid, it still does not detract from the need for federal assistance in order to alleviate the extra fiscal burden that besets host cities and thereby discourage any tendency on their part to exert their pound of flesh on the health of state users of the port. In my view, it is better for Lagos State to leverage on its political affinity with the ruling class to intensify its campaign for special grants to Lagos State as a former federal capital territory in place of work landing. If we look at how much is being generated from that, we see that the impact on the profile of the state may actually be negative. The fact that arguments or debates had not gone in favor of Lagos State at the National Assembly doesn't mean that the entire enterprise should be arrested. This could continue through successive administration until the battle is won. So ladies and gentlemen, I quickly look at the evolution of multiplicity of taxes. It was Soren Kierkegaard who said, life must be understood backwards, but it must be lived forward. In order to develop the appropriate responses to the menace of multiplicity of taxes, we need to trace how and why it crept into the tax system of Nigeria. And there's a singer who said the military did bad thing. So they did a lot of bad things as far as the tax system is concerned. And what did they do? As soon as the military came, in order to become popular, they abolished some state taxes, they unified some state taxes. Taxes can never be uniform in the federal system. There are taxes, there are states who may even choose not to impose certain taxes because of certain policy objectives. So they reduced, so we began the race to the bottom, unified taxes, and it got to a point where the states virtually became dependent on the federal for its revenue every month. So it stopped all the initiatives, all the competition relating to revenue generation. The situation got so bad that at the time, some of the states did not even have a functional board. Then, the boards of some states were mere units in the Ministry of Finance. So, some very smart tax consultants came together, put a proposal together, and said, we can do something to help you. And they said, if we are able to mark up your revenue by this margin, we will take this percentage. The consultants invested heavily, and they demonstrated boldness. They revitalized some of the redundant provisions of the tax law, which, given tax practice, I wasn't a practitioner at that time. Practitioners had to look at the books and say, all these things that they are doing, are they really in the tax law? And they found them that they were there. For example, this training, yes, section 104. And they said, truly, all what these guys are doing are in the law. So, states was trying very hard to generate revenue through means. States, they introduced sales tax. That ran into some constitutional problems in the case of Alaja and Ikagaruwa and AG of Ogun State. So they were in search of desperate solutions. So what they did was some military administrators actually gave them the full backing to actually go and do as much as they can do under the program called Accelerated Revenue Generation. Apart from the statutory stipulated taxes, they also look at other revenue heads, and this is where some aspect of multiplicity of taxes started. So they say, how can someone want CFO and they be charging 5,000 naira? How can somebody want to put a kiosk? So NAFDAC, they started collecting huge amount of money. The money that you need to build a house, now you can use it to process permit alone, and it also takes a long time. So they started all this. And because of the huge revenue potentials and the revenue need, the military administrator at that time gave them all the support. because the revenue was paramount. So in the course of time, other states gradually bought into this program, which started in Niger State. They bought into it, including Lagos State, and that was when Lagos State revenue phenomenally increased. So the number of taxpayers are not happy. Nobody is happy paying taxes. Nobody pays tax with smiles. So they went to court and challenged a host of the actions of the tax consultants, but most of the actions failed on the basis that no one can challenge an edict or a decree of the military government. So all those cases failed on preliminary grounds. So like I said, when all these were developing, stakeholders in taxation, they didn't just fold their hands. There are people here who fought tooth and nail to make sure that this menace was curtailed, because they discovered that it was killing the tax system. And I'm happy to see here the doyen of the tax transition profession in Nigeria, and also Mr. J.K. Naiju, who was at that time at the end of affairs. So they used JTB as the engine of incubations of appropriate policies to do something. So what did they do? They came up with a circular directing states not to exceed certain limits, and also they challenged states or prohibited states from introducing certain taxes that were not from that circular. Of course, you can see the attitudes of states that have attorney generals who will advise them on the limits of their power. So they just looked at it and said, look, JTB did not have power to do all this. So they continued. So JTB went to the drawing board and then enacted the provisions of that circular into law. And this helped a great deal, but it didn't solve the problem. These are the summary of that decree. The decree 1 seeks to override the provisions of the Constitution, because at that time they felt that they wanted to make a law that would provide a new legal order. 2, it prohibited any other person except tax authorities from collecting taxes. And it also said members of the police force shall only be used in accordance with the provisions of the tax law. It prohibited anybody from mounting roadblocks, and it prescribed the amounts chargeable for certain levies. For example, renewal of premises levy, registration of premises, business premises levy, and all that. Then it imposed penalties, 50,000 imprisonment for 3 years. Very great intervention. Captain 2 stopped some of the manifestations, or arrested some of the manifestations of the tax consultants for a while, but not permanently. So the consultants devised new means. They devised new methods, because that law actually hinted at the jugular of the tax consultants, some of whom have become very prosperous and very influential. And what did they do? They changed their modus operandi. So they started operating. They even moved their offices to the boss, and they started generating documents which the board chair was signing. So they were able to seamlessly carry on the operation as if they were part of the board. So JTB returned to the drawing board and mobilized towards the amendment of the Personal Income Tax Act. They said, every state must now have a board. I don't know how a state can collect taxes without a board. So JTB said, every state must now. Imagine it now is the federal government that now said states should do the right thing in this regard. So Yet we also, the law also prescribed a composition for these boards. So consultants now moved to the local government because they could no longer operate at the state. So multiplicity of taxes now became a national problem. JTB also went to the drawing board and then said every local government should also have a revenue authority, which was commendable. I don't know how local government can operate without a structure, established structure. The treasury in at the local government level in those days were very functional. So they said, put in place a revenue committee for each state and also have something like states initiated another reform. And they said, the Minister of Finance should amend the schedule to the taxes and levies approved for collection. And stakeholders were thinking that that will actually either phase out that law or reduce significantly the number of taxes on it. But unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, that amendment increased the number of levied items on that law from 39 to 55. That didn't happen under the watch of Ms. Kenny. But she has inherited the problem, and I have some recommendations on how this can be resolved, because it's the same government. So, ladies and gentlemen, we can see that if we rely on the fact that there are now 55 payment items in Nigeria, we can predict what the outcome, the next survey on ease of paying taxes in Nigeria might be. So if we are serious and want to build on the success of on the improvement in the area of ease of doing business survey, then we need to do something relating to this. So ladies and gentlemen, I quickly move to some of the things that I thought are wrong with the federal law and the Lagos law. And my ability to convince you that those laws, as well intended as they might have been, are not indeterminate will determine whether what I'm saying makes sense or not. So page 36. Why chapter 2 and chapter 91, L91, have helped in generally curbing the proclivity of states and local governments in introducing new levies without proper legal backing? A critical review of some of their contents will reveal that they have not been able to put an end to multiplicity of taxes. Part of the strategies for curbing multiplicity of taxes include establishing revenue agencies for the state and local government and prescribing their composition under PITA. This approach is a carryover from the military era, which cannot fit into the framework of the 1999 Constitution. It is submitted that the federal government cannot lawfully establish agencies for the states and dictate the membership of such agencies. This matters, in my view, at the prerogative of each state. Some states have asserted their independence by enacting laws establishing their board of internal revenue under their own law, which enable each state to seize initiatives to amend the provisions of the law as they consider appropriate from time to time, instead of going to the National Assembly. It is on record that Lagos State was the first to make this bold initiative, even before the federal government established the FIRS under a separate statute. Lagos State saw the need to create a functional board that will be semi-autonomous or autonomous, and that will also be able to innovate and do a lot of things which the normal civil service regulations will constrain them. Then a statutory provision is incapable of overriding the provisions of the 1999 Constitution. in view of Section 1, Subsection 3 of the 1999 Constitution, which entrenches the doctrine of constitutional supremacy. Section 1, Subsection 1, and Section 2, Subsection 1, which are actually the soul of those laws, of the federal law, I mean, beg your pardon, started with the phrase, notwithstanding anything contained in the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria 1979 as amended, which seeks to give the provisions of Chapter 2 overriding effect above the Constitution. Thus, the listing of the value-added tax in Part 1 of the schedule to the Act is sufficient in the view of the drafters of that law to make it a federal tax. Also, by enumerating the taxes collectible by the states under Part 2, will override the provision of Section 4 of the Constitution, which made the taxing power of the state residual. Whereas the states are entitled under the Constitution to impose any tax that is not on the exclusive legislative list or on the concurrent legislative list. It is submitted that no matter how many taxes a state may choose to impose within the limits of its power under the Constitution, no federal statute could validly circumscribe the power of the state in a manner not envisaged by the 1999 Constitution. Little wonder that both federal and some states have enacted new taxes, which the 2015 amendment of Chapter 2 had now taken on board, which will now justify some of these things as far-sighted and as forward-looking. Then also, Section 2.2 of Chapter 2 provides, and members of the Nigerian Police Force shall only be used in accordance with the provisions of the tax law. Apparently, this was a response to the prevailing practice, whereby in this training, they will go with truckloads of armed and mobile police. So when people raise the issue and say, what about the mobile police? They say, mobile police is still police. So people said, this is not the right way to go, and JTB felt this was wrong. And they now said, but what I think that provision should have targeted that being to actually try to amend the provisions of the personal income tax that gave them that power in the first instance. Instead of, because even when the tax consultants left the states only moved to fill their spaces. Because right now, federal and states, they are still destraining. They are still destraining, and the reform I would recommend in this regard is one that would limit the power to the strength to the taxpayers and not the agent of collection. Because agents of collections are not the taxpayers under personal income tax law. And if there are issues between the agents of collections for which they are not remunerated, there are ways and means of resolving this within the legal system rather than destraining them. So Chapter 2 also seeks to prohibit states from engaging private tax consultants in the administration of state taxes. I don't think they have the power to do this. You see about this, and I align totally in that. Where somebody was detained in the course of late drive and was put in a van, they went to court and then challenged it. And the court said the officials who are involved in that act cannot take coverage under the edict in force at that time. So can we say people should go to court? That is going to be medicine after death. So we need to do something in order to. The issue was so much that the tax study group in 2003 recommended that all the items on the fourth schedule in the 1999 budget should be deleted. They said, no local government is doing all this. And these are the avenues that what they are doing, their practices took root from these provisions. And they said, even they said they would have advised that local government system to be totally abolished. This recommendation, however, misses the point in my view. The medicine for headache is not to behead a person suffering from headache. As a matter of fact, we need to take services to the people through the local government. So rather than consigning the local government to the trash can, the challenge in my view is to strengthen the local government and make the local government system to work the way they used to work in the past. When I was growing up, local government system worked. In fact, local government used to be at our backyard, and they used to come to our premises to do certain inspection. So we didn't have to do monthly or weekly inspection, maybe
sanitation,
because they were very, very effective. So we need to go back to that era. So policy, legal, and administrative imperatives. Improvements on a country's ranking on the ease of paying taxes index requires conscious and deliberate effort to address some of the key performance indices which are usually taken into account in the survey. We can see what we did to gain that mileage with regards to ease of doing business in Nigeria. And I'm happy to see that Dr. Jumoke Oduwole is in the audience. They had to work very hard on each of the indices to do something about it. The first time I traveled out of Nigeria and they asked me to go, I said, just like that. I didn't believe that it was the same Nigeria. It didn't take me five. It was as if I was using a diplomatic passport, and but that applied to everybody. They needed to take all these issues one by one. So to this end, federal government, as the minister has said, is committed to doing something. And that is why the revised National Tax Policy 2017 had recommended a tax system that is few and without double taxation. And I reproduce the provisions of the National Tax Policy on page 44. Consequently, the federal government should take steps, both steps, to streamline the company's income tax, the tertiary education tax, and the information technology tax into one. The police have come at a time to also say, we need security tax. And what could be more justifiable? Because that's the primary reason for the state. So we need to do something relating to this and ensure that these agencies are sufficiently funded in order to continue to do their intervention. I know what TED Fund is doing in this school, and I will want TED Fund to do more with consumption tax. It should take an informed decision whether to stay with VAT or go the whole of in implementing the consumption tax. If it chooses the latter, which to me is a better option, the base of consumption tax should be widened beyond tourism and hospitality sector. This will require an amendment of the existing law. The Lagos State should urgently take steps to send 4 bills to the National Assembly repealing produce sales tax law, trade cattle control and tax law, sales tax law, and neighborhood improvement charge law, which are currently on its laws. And when the opportunity to revise the laws of Lagos State also presents itself, the stamp duties law should simply be removed, because it belongs on each level of government to accept responsibility and take some of the recommendations touching on them in this lecture seriously. We have identified the confusion inherent in the use of the phrase taxes and levies, and we have said that we should disentangle them. We have recommended that we should try and apply the provisions of Utility Charges Commission Act by extending the provision to levies and also introducing same on the state level. A good tax system requires sound regulatory framework to track as many activities as possible. Also monitor and enforce compliance. Accordingly, to have a good tax system, there must be reliable data which is updated periodically on residents, on acquisition and disposal of assets, on sale of goods, and so on. Data can be mined through various engines, and that is what the federal government is doing now under this. They're trying to generate data of those people who are living rich or who have never filed returns, those who are acquiring property and they have never filed returns. So the same thing you can use the NBA to achieve. But this is possible only where to drastically reduce the cost so that more and more people can access their services. So we have considered the various attempts, noble attempts indeed, made in the past to address the problem. And I use this opportunity to acknowledge the role of JTB in this regard. While we are mandated to be noble sector through federal legislation to act. You certainly mean that I've taken address at the state level. At the recent forum, Justice Kandi took me up and he said that I've been too hard on the issues of captivity. I should recognize some of the meaning about which I mean. But my worry is that to what extent can we use federal intervention? We can only do it for a while. It's not going to be sustainable. All the problems associated with the phenomenon, which has defined solution for almost 3 decades, can be exhaustively addressed. It cannot be exhaustively addressed in 1 hour presentation. I do hope that my presentation will set a new tone for the engagements by stakeholders. With every level of government playing its part, I'm hopeful that multiplicity of taxes will soon be the king of parts in Lagos State and in Nigeria. Ladies and gentlemen,